Good evening, everyone. One announcement. Next Tuesday is the last lecture here, and then I go to Israel. So we will have at least a month off. After the lecture I will give here next Tuesday, I will go to another shul right here with Rabbi Yosef Falachi. And it's going to be a nice big event over there. I see even $1,000 cash raffle if you win it. It's 2013 East 13th Street, Derech Emet Congregation. It'll be a late lecture. I think it's the holiday eve of the Goyim, right? So there's a few more flyers. Anyone who wants to go, put it in shul or in his area, you can take them here on your way out. Well, that's going to be the last lecture I give before I leave, Bezrat Hashem. As you know, I came back last night from a very, very successful trip to Las Vegas and to Houston, Texas. And something very interesting I found, Las Vegas having more and more Jews moving there. And there's two Las Vegas. There's Las Vegas, which is 10 times worse than Sodom and Amora, you know, where all the hotels and the casino. And then there is a suburb, quiet area where the Jews have a big shul and more family moved in. Nothing to do with the Sodom area. And the reason a lot of Jews moved to Las Vegas is because the price of a house there is a third from LA. The life there is much, much, much cheaper. It's very hard to keep up with the expensive cost of living of New York in LA. The two most expensive places in America. Then I moved to Houston, even better. Houston, you pay $2 for gas, that's it. No taxes on gas. Houses are very cheap, $200,000-$300,000, you get a nice house there. But at the same time, you know what's the minimum wage there? I think it's less than $10. In New York, what can you do with $10 an hour? Very hard to survive. But the good news is that a lot of people got inspired. And I already heard a few of them already starting to keep Shabbat. Baruch Hashem, very good. Excellent. Every one of these trips creates new Baalei Tshuva. Also bring an awareness to the area. The rabbi from Las Vegas called me today. And this was his words. He said, what you did in one weekend here, it's a year of Kiruvir. A year. We can't do it in a year, what was done in 2 days. That's why I always tell people, when it's intensive, it works. When it's quiet and pleasant, everybody goes back to his illusion and dreams. Nobody changed. People change only when they realize there's a price to pay. Remember this rule. And no matter what other people tell you, don't fall into their nonsense. The only time people change, of course, is rarely people with very pure souls, high souls, that it's enough that they hear one nice lecture about the parasha and they're willing to become religious. Yes, here and there you find people like this. With the massive brainwash against the Torah, with the massive brainwash against Judaism, against Hashem, against everything religious, to take someone that is brainwashed for 10, 20, 30 years, every minute of his life against God and the Torah, and to turn him into a Shomer Shabbos, learning Torah, listening to lectures that within 2-3 weeks is already a religious person, putting tzitzit, putting tefillin. It's not an easy mission, as you know. And the only way to do it is the way to make people understand. If you will ignore what you just heard, you're gonna one day have to deal with that. You're gonna deal with the consequences and it will be horrible for you. That's still no guarantee that the people are smart enough to get the point. Still no guarantee. The world is full of foolish people. I don't know how you wanna call them, stupid, foolish, brainless, you decide, that they will hear. And they know, because they saw the proofs, they know you're not making it up, they saw in the Torah, They're not even denying. You're right, you proved to me the Torah is from God. And yet they still continue to live the way they are and they ignore what they saw. There are people like this. What's the solution with them? Nothing. There's no solution. Somebody saw everything. And he knows the serious price to pay. And after all of that, he still continued to live with his lifestyle, to break Shabbat, to eat not kosher, to go to the clubs, to make scenes at night, and the rest of his nonsense. You maybe have a better idea. I don't see any more solution to someone like this. Besides one, sometimes it feels horrible that you put 2-3 hours into people, they admit that the Torah is divine, and they still don't want to change. It's a horrible feeling. It's like a doctor that worked on a surgery with a patient for 3 hours. He did everything right, but the patient died. You hear it on the news sometimes. They say, the surgery, הניתוח היה מוצלח, אבל החולה נפטר. The surgery was successful, but the patient died. What? From something unexpected. Some virus in a hospital, I don't know, germ. Nothing to do with it. Surgery, they show you on a video. We did exactly what the books say. We open, we cut, we clean, we sewed. What happened? Unexpected infection killed him. So the surgery was successful. You know, you did everything right. And the patient did not live. He stayed to live, to die. So that's very bad feeling. Even though you know that now his share to the world to come to me. I didn't lose. He lost. I didn't lose. I get his share. I put time into him, showing all the truth. He decided to stay a goy. Where is his share going to go to? The books explain his share comes to the person who tried to save his soul. If he doesn't want to save his soul, the person who tried to save his soul will get that soul. Very logical. Mida keneged mida. You cared about my soul. I didn't care about my soul. I lost my soul, so who's going to get it? Who's going to get it? The grandma? The guy that tried everything he can. Okay. So even though you know you get his share to the world to come, you still feel horrible. Because you know what's going to be his end. And you think to yourself, maybe if I put another 20 minutes effort, so I don't know what, maybe this guy will be saved. Obviously, there's no end to it. And it happens. But there is only still one more hope. What is it? Right now, there's something in psychology, it's called cognitive dissonance. Did you hear about this expression? Cognitive dissonance means that what you understand in your brain in minutes or in hours may take the heart many years to understand. Meaning the heart and the brain do not work in the same speed. What the brain understands in minutes or hours, it may take the heart years to digest and to accept. It's very interesting how the heart, it's very, very slow. It's similar to lightning and thunder. When you see a lightning, you hear after half a minute, you hear the thunder. But the lightning and the thunder started in the same second. When there was an explosion in Shamaim, explosion, that explosion created the spark, which we call lightning, and the voice of the, it's like a bomb, will arrive to us 30 seconds later just because the speed of the light is much faster than the speed of the voice. That's all, but it was sent at the same time. Just one is running much faster than the other, that's all. It's similar over here, the same thing. You spoke to his brain and to his heart at the same time. The brain got it. After 2 hours, he got the whole point. If you connect him to a light detector, you will see that he knows everything. But the heart fights. Amazing. It happens when Albert Einstein published his results. All the scientists in the world were so shocked. None of them agreed to accept his results. No, can't be. Can't be. Can't be we were all wrong all alone. Can't be the whole world lived in a lie. It can't be. We don't accept it. But when they checked it, they came to the same exact results. Nobody can contradict it. How many years they fought him until they surrendered and accepted his results? How many years? 7 years. The whole world is checking his results, coming to the same conclusion again and again and again and again and again and again, all over the world. Nobody wanted to accept his discoveries until 7 years later. What they understood in a day or two took their heart 7 years to surrender. Same thing, Paro. We can see now in a parashot. He understood everything when Moshe spoke to him in 2 minutes, at least after 2-3 plagues. When you saw that Moshe means business, it's very serious, we would get the point. We couldn't be so stupid. If he tells you tomorrow that's what's going to happen, or tonight that's what's going to happen, for sure, he knew it's going to happen. You already proved yourself 2-3 times. I am not doubting you that you have abilities. So in the head, he understood. But in the heart, just the thought to release millions of slaves, I can't do that. Resistance. So what am I saying here, actually? So when you speak to someone and he say to you, yeah, it's all true, I really don't have what to answer or to contradict, but I'm not interested. I'm not interested. What is going to be the outcome of that? Hashem has his ways. Before he spoke to you, everything by him was random. Bad luck, Russian roulette, I should have left the house early. Why did I come here today? It's a rainy day, I should have not left the house. I knew this car is not good to drive in the snow. All kinds of excuses. Now, after he heard me, there's no more excuses, because now he knows everything that happens to him from now on is the hand of Hashem. What you planted is in his head, there's no way to take it out. You can't come and tell a person, hey, by the way, you're not my biological son. We adopted you when you were a baby. And then an hour later, hey, I was just joking. That's it, it's in. Then he begins to see, I really don't look anything like my parents. What's going on over here? I always wonder why I don't look like them. Or he heard the father and the mother speaks in the kitchen and he overheard them. No, you didn't understand, we didn't mean, no, don't get the wrong idea, forget about it, I already know, it's in my head, there's no way to get it out. Now, all his life, he lives with that knowledge. When you prove to him the Torah is from Hashem and what's going to be the end of Mechalel Shabbat, and he's a Mechalel Shabbat, do you think you can get it out? No. So he's going to lie to himself and try to forget it and keeps fighting with himself because the heart refused to surrender. But Hashem has his way. 2-3 weeks later, boom, accident. The car is total. One, help. It's a help, it's not a punishment. I'm helping you to get the point. Sometimes a smack makes a kid understand what 500 speeches doesn't get him to understand, especially babies. If you tell your baby, don't put your finger inside the electric. Don't touch, no. It smiles to you. I told you no, doesn't help. You take his hand, no! Screams for 2-3 minutes, never dare to come near it. The smack you gave him was a punishment or was a life-saving hug? Depend who you ask. If you ask the liberal Jews here, shame on you, we should call 911 on you. You hit the hand of the baby. What kind of a cruel father you are? You are the cruel idiots. We are smart. We want to save the life of our children. You are the stupid ones. Call 911 on your father to try to help you not to make you a drug addict or to get electrocuted. If your father does not agree to become a girl, call 911 on him. Every week, another kid wants to be a girl. Why is it? They told me now when I was in Houston, 2 twins were born. Age 4, the parents decided that one of them is more a girl than a boy. Put earring on him, change his clothes, and change his name to Maya. raised him now as a boy, getting ready to make an operation. And he said to me, some of the people who got angry when they found out you come to speak here, you have to see the wonderful comments they give to the parents. You're so great. You're such great parents. You're so open-minded. We are so proud of you. And you wonder why they hate me, parents like this. If that's what they want for their children, I don't want to be loved by monsters like this. I don't want to look at them. I don't want to stand in the same room like them, like these criminals. I don't know what are they, big criminals or big idiots. One way or the other is bad. And they put the show. And you know what? It's not a show anymore. Because there's no more shame. When do you have to put a show? When you are embarrassed. So you put a show. It's commercial. Commercial time. Chanukah music. Very good. You got the mitzvah, David. The guy's neshama felt that the tzaddik is coming. Right away, he shut it off. Anyway, so one way or the other, either it's a show, or either really that they are really proud of it. They put a show that they're proud of it. Like all the gays in a parade, they call it in Israel Mitzad HaGaava, the pride parade. Proud? You're proud about what? That you live against the law of nature? Forget religion. There's laws of nature. Everybody who contradict the laws of nature is obviously mentally sick. It was obvious all along for thousands of years. All of a sudden it became normal. There was nobody there on the open to do things that is against the law of nature, regardless of religion. We're not talking about religion now. Religion is another issue. Even secular people, but I told you the story that when I was a kid in school, we were 400 people in public school. And there was one like those in our place, one out of 400 kids. And his life was so horrible. Today when you look back at it, you cannot believe how this guy was coming to school. All secular kids, nothing to do with religion. Nobody did it because it says in the Torah not to be gay or things like that. Just because it was so disgusting to us as children, little children, seventh grade, eighth grade, all day people were pulling his hair off, kicking him, cursing him, pushing him on the floor, running after him in the hallway. Just out of nowhere, somebody comes and kicks him. People went crazy just to look at him. How he was talking like a woman and this. The interesting part is how someone like this continued to come to school. I don't understand, looking back, what kid in the world would agree to come the next day after the trauma he had? Today, if the teacher doesn't let the kid go to the bathroom, he doesn't want to go to school anymore. He's harassing me. It's an abuse. You want to know abuse? That kid was abused non-stop for 8 years in school. Non-stop. He was the only one in the whole city. Today, have tens of thousands everywhere you go. Everywhere you go, almost every store you go, the seller is there, the student on the flight. Everywhere you go, on the open. One person told me that it has to be something that we eat, or breathe, or something in the water, something that play with the brain. Who knows, maybe. Who knows? Maybe one day we'll find out that the reason that you have such an epidemic in the world today is something in the food that we eat. Maybe they make mutations in the wheat, barley, corn. Who knows? I don't know. I really don't know. Yeah, but it's a little bit logical because it doesn't really make sense that all of a sudden a third of the world became contradicting the law of nature. There's never been in history something like this. And only get worse. Every week it gets worse. Yesterday I spoke about, they published in Israel shocking statistic. Yesterday, shocking statistic. All the immigrants who came to Israel, more than 1 million, almost all of them goyim. almost all of them. 96% of the Russians that came to Israel are 100% goyim. The Israeli secular government published it, not the religious. According to halakha, only 4% of the Russians are Jewish. They're all goyim, completely. Among the rest, 70%, 80%, 72%, but together, if you put everyone together, conclusion, 84% of the immigrants were non-Jewish. Only 16% were Jewish. 16%. And this 16%, many of them are not religious. Mechalel Shabbos, so they also consider like goyim. But leave it alone for now. At least we can make them Baal Tshuva. There's a chance. So what's going on here? So now, give it another 20 years, the majority of the people in Israel, it could be now already, I don't know. We have to check the numbers. We have about 2 million Israeli Arabs, few hundred thousand Druzim, lots of Thailandi, 120,000 from Sudan and Eritrea, lots of Goyim from Romania, close to 900,000 Russian Goyim, and other from France, America, other Goyim that also came. It's very, very possible that the majority of the people in Israel right now are not Jewish. Very, very possible. As a matter of fact, if you add up the numbers, that's what it looks like. Do you know what it means? Everything goes after the majority. One, you have majority of people righteous in a town, Hashem loves that town. The majority of the people are wicked, the righteous die with the wicked. Once the Satan gets permission to destroy the place, he doesn't tell the difference between good and bad anymore. You live with them, you pay the price. If the majority, not that the goyim are bad, some of the goyim are much better than the Jews I know. It's not, we're not comparing good or bad here. Comparing Jews or non-Jews, that's all. So, if the majority of the people in Israel are not Jewish, that means it's not the state of Israel anymore. It's an international state. Yeah, from all over the world, like New York. New York, it's not an American place. The majority of the people in New York are immigrants. Italians, Irish, Greeks, Arabs, Indian, Pakistani, Israeli, Persian, Chinese. Just in Chinatown alone, I think you have hundreds of thousands of Chinese. So if you add Astoria, all Greeks, you go to some neighborhood from islands, from all kinds of places. I don't think there's one nationality in the world that don't have a community. So everybody know. I remember that's the first thing I was told when I came to America, 1989. They told me, whatever you see in New York, it's not America. New York, it's not America. Back then they told me that. New York, it's not America. New York, it's a combination of all the countries. It's an international place. But other places, you know, you have only Americans. You go to certain states, it's almost everybody American. American born. So, if the majority are not Jewish, then why should Hashem make miracles for a nation that is not his children? All the miracles that the Torah described, I did for you, I did for you, I did for you, because you are the children of Abraham, Yitzchak, and Yaakov. But if everybody here is not the children of Abraham, Yitzchak, and Yaakov, what existence the place has? Remember, there's no more reasons for Hashem to perform the miracles, because Hashem said, I'm doing things for you not because you deserve it, because I promised to Abraham, Yitzchak, and Yaakov to benefit their children, not because you're righteous. That's two reasons the Torah gave for us to come to Israel. One, I swore to Abraham, Yitzchak, and Yaakov, I can't break my word. And two, the Gentiles that lived in Israel were all wicked idol worshippers. So they were worse than you. You are bad, but they were worse. Meaning, if you have a person that is a thief and he steals in millions, and you have a thief that steals in thousands, so we have to let one of them enter your house. Which one would you prefer? One of them has to come in. The one that steals millions in every shot, or the ones that steals thousands? At least this is a smaller criminal. Let's deal with him. No? That's basically what Hashem told us, if we try to be honest. Not that you were good, that the goyim were much worse than you. That's why I'm kicking them out of Israel and I'm giving you the land of Canaan. So two reasons. One is Avraham, Yitzchak, and Yaakov. And second, that the goyim were worse than you. And those two reasons are gone. That's it. There's no more children of Avraham, Yitzchak, and Yaakov in Israel. They're not the majority. The majority are not children of Avraham, Yitzchak, and Yaakov. Children of Esav, children of Ishmael. Yes. Children of Avraham, Yitzchak, and Yaakov only. And they're becoming the minority in Israel. And the second thing is, I don't think that the Israelis are more righteous than these goyim. The Arabs in Israel keep more mitzvot than most Israelis. They don't eat chazir. Many Israelis do. They don't charge interest from each other. Not that they have to. It doesn't count for the mitzvot. But they do it because it says in the Torah not to charge interest. Their women dress more modest. There are certain things they won't do. So, reality-wise, we lost those two gifts. One is Avraham, Yitzchak, and Yaakov, because it's the majority is not Avraham, Yitzchak, and Yaakov. And second, you can't prove that we are better than the goyim who lives in Israel. You can't prove it. So in that case, maybe the goyim are not worse than us. And if they are not worse than us, they're going to take the land. And if you think it's not possible that Hashem will kick us completely from the land of Israel, think again. Why? Because there is a verse in the Torah. Ki lo timaker haaretz letzmitut. The land will not be given permanently. Ki li haaretz. I'm the master of the land. I'm the master of the land. And I decide who's going to get it and who doesn't. So yes, I gave it to you. That's why I kicked those seven nations out of Israel. But no guarantee that you're going to stay there forever. It's all depend how you're going to behave. By the way, which sin makes Jews leave Israel the most? They lose the merit to sit in Israel. Which sin? Do you know? Let me give you a hint. The hint is, what mitzvah gives you the right to live in Israel? Circumcision. Brit Milah. Lezaracha eten ta'aretz. For what? I'm going to give your children the land for the mitzvah of Brit Milah. The Zohar say, why you have Arabs in Israel? You can't get rid of them. You can't get rid of them until Mashiach comes. Only then they would have to leave. But until he comes, they will leave there. There's nothing you can do about it. Because they also do Brit Milah. They also do Brit Milah. And when they do Brit Milah, they have the right to sit in the land. But the Zohar say Brit Milah has two steps. First is the cutting, the Milah. And second is the Priya, meaning taking the skin down. They don't do it, the Arabs, because by the time they circumcise their babies, not when they're 8 days old. They do it 13, they do it later. Even if they do it when they're babies, it doesn't have to be right away. It can be later. They don't do Priya anyway, even if they circumcised the baby the day he was born in a hospital, giving him vitamin K for the blood to clog. So they circumcise a lot of babies in a hospital in the first day or two when they're born, but they still don't do Priya, the goyim. They don't know all the halachot of Brit Milah. And the Gemara say, mal velo para, keilu lo mal. If you made the cutting without bringing the skin down, the foreskin, you don't bring it down, what's left, then it's like you did not circumcise the baby. But after all, you did something. So that something, a part of the mitzvah, gives you a temporary position in the Holy Land. But the Zohar say the same way their circumcision is incomplete, their sitting in the land of Israel, it's incomplete. It will not be for good. Once Mashiach comes, they will all have to clear the area. Do you understand? But they still get something. 2,000 years they're there already. They're living there, the Arabs. So they get something. And you see that that's the way it is. Now, what sin gets you to lose the right to sit in Israel? not keeping the brit, wasting seed, making sins with women, homosexuality, all kinds of sex crimes. Single guys and girls, a married woman who cheat, all kinds of things like this. That's called pgama brit, defecting the brit, the covenant with Hashem when it comes to brit milah. And the Torah say, if that's what people do, the land will vomit them out of Israel. Just like you vomit something bad out of your body. That's what the Torah say. Taki ha'aretz etchem. That's the words of the Torah. The land will vomit you out of the Holy Land. Because you don't deserve to walk in the Holy Land. You don't deserve to live there. So what happened? Hashem throw you to exile. Now, the sad part is, most Jews that came from Israel to America, they're very happy from that exile. It's been going on and on and on, and they're not seem to suffer. I know some Israelis, I meet them in the airports usually, on flights, they come to say hi to me. Recently I was just there and a woman came, she's married to an American, she has American kids. Religious woman, nice woman. She said they love the lectures and this. And by the way, in between the lines, she told me how much she suffers every time she goes on a visit to Israel. Even on a visit. You know, there's problems. I'm not saying there's no problems. But she's like so happy that she lives in America. So I also, one time, spoke very highly of the exile. And the rabbi that runs my yeshiva in Yerushalayim, very clever, he told me this sentence. He told me, how great is Hashem? He punishes a person and he makes it sweet to him. That he doesn't even suffer from the punishment. Meaning, you were kicked out of Israel. This was 30 years ago. And you seem to enjoy the punishment you got. Why? Two reasons. Why would a person enjoy exile in America? If they send you to Uganda, I'm sure you won't enjoy that exile. You know, people shoot these, kidnapping kids, raping them, all these places that you hear 12 years old go with machine guns and murder people. Shem Yirachem, these dangerous countries. You don't want to live there, that's for sure. Even South Africa, you can walk there at night. People can steal your car. With a gun, get out of the car, you never see your car again. It's dangerous to walk at night. Here it's getting like that. It's very difficult to be a Jew. They murder an Orthodox Jew today in Cleveland, you heard? Every day an incident, every day. Every day an incident. Every day an incident here, every day an accident in Israel with public transportation. Yesterday some bus close to the airport hit something, 4 people died. I told you, since they passed the law that they're going to have public transportation on Shabbat, every day there's been a brutal accident with death. People dying. Lots of people dying in accident. Way more than the average. I saw a chart in countries, the level of accidents with casualties, it's very low. 5%, 7%, 9%. Israel, 35%, 40%. You have to see. It's like the Empire State Building compared to a private home. That's how it looks in a graph. And people don't get the point. And don't think that the roads in Israel are anything less than here. If any, they're better than here. They used to be very bad until 20 years ago. They invested billions and billions to make great roads, wide roads. So, and you know how many motorcycle accidents you have? You know how many paralyzed young kids on wheelchair for the rest of their life you have? I met few. By the way, here one, another one, here one. That they're on wheelchair for the rest of their life from an accident on a motorcycle. Yeah, just in Houston, Texas, after the lecture, there was a nice boy, maybe 20 years old, maybe 19 years old, walking with, what's the name of that? Crutches. Crutches. Walking with crutches, and I asked him, what happened, basketball accident? He said, no, motorcycle accident. 6 months. 6 months, he got lucky, he still can walk. Some people, it breaks, smash their spine, still on a wheelchair for 7 years now. Imagine life like this, 7 years on a chair. Imagine this. Young man cannot get married, cannot go to the bathroom, cannot do anything. He needs a maid to change him, diapers, whatever you want to call it. Horrible. All the muscles are not functioning anymore because there's no movement. Such a punishment, Hashem Yirachem. Such punishment, there are such punishments in life when you look at how much people suffer. We cry sometimes for small things, but there are some people that have all the right to cry when you see how their life look. Just cannot believe it. Just can't believe. It's crazy. So many tragedies, so many punishments. And still people live in illusion. Do whatever you like. Hashem loves everyone. There's no punishment. There's nothing to worry about. No matter what happened, they're still not getting the point. We're now in the middle of Chanukah. As we're lighting the candles, third candle tonight. I've been talking in the last few months about a question that bothers me. I really don't understand. Why would the secular people want to celebrate Chanukah? Why? Chanukah is the holiday that symbolizes the defeat of the wicked people that fought the Torah. And when you look at the secular people in Israel, at least half of them, maybe much more even, but at least half of them vote for parties in the Knesset that declared, give us the vote that we should destroy the Torah. We should make civil marriage, we cancel the religious marriage, we fight the yeshivot, we cut their budgets, we close this, That's what they declare, and they got a lot of seats. Half of the Knesset is people that hate the Torah, hate religion. Half of the Knesset, each seat in the Knesset, how many votes is that, do you know? 50,000 votes. Yes, 50,000 times 120, 6 million people. 14 Arabs you have, identified with terror, praising it, calling the Arabs that murder innocent Jews on the street, shahids. If you have a member in the government that speak and somebody just went and hit few people on the sidewalk with a car and killed them, and he comes on a speech and call them holy. In America, somebody like this could be free another minute. Forget about senator. Free. Would he be able to walk? I doubt it very much. But in Israel, they do whatever they want. They laugh in our faces. We have to pay them a salary also. That's the price of the stupid democracy. You have to cooperate with your enemies and help them to destroy you. Even if they declare in your face that that's what they're going to do. Why? You have to give them rights. Not that America is any better, but there's some red lines here. In Israel, there's no red lines. They will speak in the Knesset, we will one day kill you all, and there's nothing you can do about it. You sit down and that's it, and you move on. Not only that, you give them the hammer to run the meetings. He runs the meeting. He decide, you talk, you be quiet. Someone who prays terrorism. Freedom of speech. Do you know who doesn't have any freedom to say a word? Religious people. Can't say a word. You can never say a word. Nobody cares. Somebody asked me today, how did something like this happen when in the last 20 years, almost all of them were an ultra-Orthodox minister of immigration was a religious Jew. Now it's Aryeh Deri, he used to be Deri before, he used to be Eli Yishai before. This is all people with black yarmulke and beards. How did they let a million goyim, that some of them are enemies of Israel, such as Amalek and Nazis, and Muslim terrorists from Sudan and Eritrea, how did they let something like this happen in 20 years? A million enemies of Israel moved into Israel. Not all of them enemies, but many of them declare that they hate Jews. They have swastikas, they have Christian cemeteries. They didn't come here to become Israelis. They came here because the Israeli government gave them $15,000, and in Russia it's a huge amount of money. $15,000, they walk 20 years, they won't save it in Russia. So they came. So the question is, how does it happen now? You have a religious minister and you understand that there will be the end of us, no? He knows it better than anyone. No, what's the answer? What do you think is the answer? If Trump will be in charge of the immigration, forget president. President just speak. There are people in charge of the offices. They're really the ones who decide what to do, what not to do. President can ask questions, they can fool him, can lie to him. What does he know? They really know what's happening. They tell the people what to do, and no one would mess with them. No one would go behind their back to the president, hey, Mr. Trump, the chairman of immigration is fooling you. He's letting a lot of Muslim terrorists into the country daily. No one will do that. They'll get fired in a second. So they can do whatever they want. If Trump was in charge of the immigration, and you would find out that every day he let hundreds of Muslim terrorists into the country, he speak one way and do the exact opposite. Would you believe such a thing? How can it be? If you find that that's the case, what could be the explanation for that? Who knows? Huh? You may think blackmail, you may think bribe, no. There is such thing as Sochnut HaYehudit, the Jewish agency. Jewish agency. They are the one who make all the decision. He is a puppet, he's nothing. I wanted to help a convert to make Aliyah to Israel. Kosher, religious, everything. No matter how much the helper of the Minister of Immigration tried, the Jewish agency turned the application down. I was wondering, how can it be? Religious girl, convert, wants to make Aliyah to Israel to get married and to have a family. They keep making all kinds of strange excuses. Reforms, right away comes in. Goyim, right away comes in and get money. Religious Jews, tricks. Tricks. Get us this, you didn't have this, oh this, ah, you've been married, you have children, prove you don't. They make all kinds of excuses instead of grabbing them. At least they are Jews for sure. Everybody else could be the enemies of Israel. In the end, the right-hand man of the minister, the minister told me he's going to help you. Whatever he tells you, do it, we're going to get her in. They couldn't get her in because the Jewish agency are controlling everything. They have the money. They have all the Zionist money. And on top of it, they get money from who? Guess from who? Christians. All these nefesh benefesh, their money comes from Christians. Christians give all the money to nefesh benefesh, to bring Jews to Israel. Why Christians are so kind? Why would they want Jews in Israel? Because they believe that JC will only come once all the Jews go to Israel. Based on the prophecies. It says that the Mashiach will gather all the Jews to Israel, right? So they believe JC is the Messiah. Okay, so Hashem fooled them and they give money for Jews to go back to Israel. I wish it would be used for Jews. We just found out who is used for. So sad. We fought so bad to get back to this country after 2,000 years, and now it's not our country anymore. Doesn't matter who's the government, it matters the majority of the people. The majority of the one demonstration, a million goyim on the streets, we don't want this, we don't want Shabbat, we don't want that, we don't want shuls, we want churches. What are you going to do? Already now in Israeli school in Herzliya, put the Christmas tree and Santa, and the whole day was a Christian day. for Israeli kids, Jews, supposedly Jews, they celebrate Christmas. Here you go. That's why it's in Herzliya. It was on the news 2 days ago. Ask that school in Herzliya, we would like to celebrate also a Jewish holiday. Will it happen? Absolutely not. You can't even step in if you have a yarmulke. Sir, it's not for you. Santa, yes, but you know. When I was getting on a plane from Houston to New York, there was one goy, Santa. You know, the goyim goes in the airport with the Santa. He did not stop smiling at me. He's from Texas. They understand over there who are the chosen people. You see from his body language how he admired me and how honored he was that he stand next to me online for the security. You had to see. Why, some of them, they still understand what it means to be the Jews, the chosen people. So I was wondering to myself, what is the point of celebrating Chanukah when your opinion and your ideology and your actions is the actions of the Greeks? You should be very upset. The Greeks and the Jews that became Greeks, they all lost. Now you officially became Greek. You became a Greek. Today you do sports, this, Greek ideology. You're not a believer. You believe in my hand, my power. You believe in gym, working out. You believe in removing your hair. You believe in all these things that the Greeks loved. So what exactly makes you a Jew? You know my friend, Rabbi Aaron Levy, a very sharp speaker. In a logical world, he should have a million views to every one of his speeches. But the corrupted world we live in, he barely have 1,000 or 2,000 views. But he's a super, super brilliant guy. Very, very smart. I'm telling you, very smart. And he gives lectures to intellectuals, and even to intellectuals, they're not in his level. So he has, it's not easy to understand because he speaks very sharp. They just spoke about, they went to speak to the Israeli jet pilots, those who fly the F-16, to give them a speech. So they warned him, be very careful. You have no permission to speak about keeping mitzvot or to try to tell them to become religious. We're warning you. And he had to speak about Chanukah. That's the topic. Who's going to speak about Chanukah? Bibi? You have to bring a religious guy to speak about Chanukah. Secular people celebrate Chanukah. Between one bite to another with the latkes and the donuts and the candles, they also want to hear about the story of Chanukah. Who was chosen for the mission? Him. Because he's very intellectual. With all due respect to them, they can't reach 5% of his brilliant head. So it's very good for them, good match. They will be very impressed that someone is actually much smarter than them in secular things. Not only in religion. In secular. They will see right away. So what happened? He went over there and he started his speech. It's very clever. Because he already knew what's going to happen. He said to them, I was invited to speak to you about Chanukah, but I'm actually not allowed to speak to you about Chanukah. Because I was told not to speak about religion. And to speak about Chanukah without speaking about religion is basically not possible. So what do you would like to talk about? So that's how, it's called in Israel, afuch al afuch, reverse psychology. Reverse psychology. When you come to a person and you tell them, listen, I would tell you the truth of the Torah, but I don't want you to get upset. What's his reaction right away? No, what are you talking about? Tell me, I want to know. If you come and say, now listen to me, I'm going to tell you exactly what's going to be your end and what the Torah says. No, get out of here. I don't want to hear. I'm not interested. So how you make him beg you? He said to him, listen, I have an amazing proofs and all this, but that's for intelligent people. People that can handle the truth. I give you an example. I had a few lectures that are so powerful, like real fire, that we wrote in a headline in Hebrew. only for people of truth, that or only for people that can handle the truth, right? They always have 3 or 4 times more views, because everyone thing is can handle the truth. It's reverse psychology. So he said to them, well, since I came to speak about Chanukah, but I was warned not to talk about religion, so basically, what would you like to talk about? So the head pilot, the one who's in charge of everyone, say, I am the boss here, and I decide what the speaker will speak, and you will speak as in anything you want. Did you hear me, young man? What happened after? I didn't finish to hear. I just heard it on my way here. So on my way back, I will hear it. What happened in the end of that lecture? By the way, a lot of these pilots became religious over the years. Actually, one of them was Mefaket Hayeset, the head of the whole unit, and became Rosh Yeshiva. One time, the pilots came to Rav Shach to speak to him in Ponovich. Introduction of Israeli secular pilots to the leader of the Haredi world. Rav Shach gave them a nice speech about life, about the purpose. And when they came out, they saw on a bulletin board somebody stuck $100 with a nail, with a note next to it. If it's yours, please take it. It was found here in Yeshiva. So the pilots looked at that, and they couldn't believe what they see. They asked the horse that took them around, tell me, what's this? He said, oh, someone found it. He doesn't know from whom. So he put it over here. If anyone lost $100, you should take it. So he asked him, and how long it's here? He told him, 3 years. They said, what? 3 years is here and no one took it? How can we take it? It's not ours. It's written over here, if you lost it, take it. I guess it was a guest that lost it. He never came back. They got the shock of their life. Later, I heard it from that guy that became religious. Later, he said that one of the reasons he became religious was that $100 bill. Because he said, in my world, as much as we try to be honest, he would not survive 3 minutes there. Forget 3 years. You understand? The same thing, it's a very similar story. That a group of religious kids from yeshiva went to the pool. There's a pool, one day boys, one day girls, in religious area. And the lifeguard is not religious. He's not religious. So they got there, he went to buy himself something to eat. He left the place. Only in Israel, you're a lifeguard, you leave the kids in the pool, and you go. He is also collecting the money. He has 2 jobs. Why should you pay 2 salaries? He's standing by the entrance, watching the kids, and at the same time, he has a box, people come, pay, he gives them a ticket, they go in. So he closed the entrance, and he went for about 30 minutes. And a group of religious kids arrive. They want to jump already to the water, but the guy's not there. So they waited by the gate. Then he showed up, and he saw that they're standing over there. So where are you? He said, we're waiting for you already 30 minutes, where are you? You in charge here? Say yes. Why, you didn't go inside? How can we go inside? We didn't pay. Mm-hmm. He says, okay, so you could pay later. Why didn't you go inside? How can we go inside? It's Gezel. So that man later told the story that minute he decided to become religious. Because he said, when I get married, that's the kids I want. I don't want other kids. If I will have a kid like that, with such values, it's worth the whole world for me. I always say, today you have to become religious, forget about the truth already. Even if you're not sure, even if nobody showed you Torah and science, and you didn't read my book, and you don't know all the proofs, just to see kids here and kids there, and you get the point. Statistically. Not that there's no bad kids by us, unfortunately the number is on the rise. It's a lot worse and worse and worse it becomes. But by them, what's going on? You have no idea what's going on over there. You have no idea what's going on over there. I think a secular teacher in a public school deserves to make $1 million, not a year, a day. Do you know what happened to secular teacher? They get kicked. They throw eggs at their head. They make flat tires in the tires. They go through such abuse, physical and verbal and all kinds of things. And when you think he's gonna call the parent to come to school to relax his son, huh? What do you think? The parent come and beat up the teacher even more. You have a kid, son of a gangster. He shows up with his bulletproof Mercedes and three bodyguards to school. Walks in. What's your name? Yeah, I'm the father of Avi. No, Avi is an angel. So it was a mistake. We mix between this Avi and another Avi. You can go, sir. Sorry for your time. Yeah, it's no joke. There are people that are so dangerous, better not to ever start a conversation with them. Better not to take that risk, because one conversation, you never know, out of nowhere, it can lead to something that get him angry, and the next thing you're dead. So what is going on here? What is going on? What's going to be? So we have a verse in Tehillim. David HaMelech writes, "Apach nishbar, va'anachnu nimlatnu." Pach, in Lashon HaKodesh, in modern Hebrew, pach means garbage can. But modern Hebrew and the language of the Torah is two different languages. Even though there's a lot of words similar, there's a lot of mistakes in the modern Hebrew. Or new words. They took words that mean one thing in the Torah and they translated it to different thing. This is one of them. Pach in Hebrew means garbage can. Pach in the Torah means a trap. So David HaMelech writes in Tehillim, the trap broke and we were escaped. We were able to escape. Pach, it's also abbreviation of two words. Pei and Chet, Purim and Chanuka. Twice in history we had a trap. The Goyim came to destroy us. Purim and Chanuka. With one difference. What was the difference? In Purim, they wanted to kill us as bodies. Kill all Jews. Religious, not religious, young, old. Jews that are strong, Jews that are 90 years old, that are not a threat, doesn't matter. We want to kill, we don't want to leave one of them alive. That's Haman. The Greeks did not want to kill the bodies. That wasn't the plan. The Greeks came to kill the soul. That's why they made specific decrees to destroy Judaism, not the Jews. If you will destroy Judaism, what do I care? Let them have kids. They're all going to be Greeks. They live among us. How many years the Greeks control Israel? Who knows? How many years? 150 years. 150 years they controlled Israel, the Greeks. And their goal was to go one or two generation, force the Jews not to circumcise their baby, because they knew that makes you non-Jew, if you are ill. Force the Jews not to keep Shabbat. If you get keep Shabbat, they kill you. Force the Jews not to learn Torah, knowing that they will always remain religious Jews if they learn Torah. So they put a ban on it. They banned the renewal of the moon. There was no Jewish calendar, so it had to be done manually every month. So they banned that you're not allowed to announce Rosh Chodesh. Why they care about Jewish calendar? Because Rosh Hashanah, Yom Kippur, Pesach, they want to destroy the religion. That's one of the foundation of the religion. The holidays, the dates. Everybody would lose everything because they're going to mix the dates. They did not allow for Jews to walk with tefillin. Remember, people used to wear tefillin all day back then in the day, not like today. Today you put tefillin in shachrit and you go. People lived all day with tefillin. No matter where you walk here, you walk with the horses, you walk in the field, They had a big turban. Under the turban, they had a tefillin. It covers everything. They wore special dresses. It covers everything. They put it. They just didn't put it around the finger. They put it around here. They stick the stripe underneath. And they lived with this all day. Well, the world we live in today, there's a lot of non-clean places. There's a lot of dogs in the street who do, you know, what they do. There's a lot of lack of modesty, and people also have gas in their stomach, which you're not allowed to have when you have the tefillin. So today, it went out of style. But I know people that wear tefillin all day still. I had a guy, he's the son of the biggest chazan, maybe one of the biggest in the world, Rav Moshe Chavusha. He was the chazan of Rav Uvadia Yosef. He loved him very much, very talented. Amazing voice, play oud, play violin, very talented chazan. His son was learning in my yeshiva in Yerushalayim for a few years. He was very serious, sitting all day with tefillin, learning all day, with tefillin all day. Baruch Hashem. So today he became a rabbi, he's giving speeches, and no, he's chacham, very chacham, his son. He's also a very sweet person. But he was sitting all day with tefillin. Why? He's in yeshiva all day. What's the problem? Learning all day Gemara. Sits with tefillin. He wants to go to the bathroom, quickly takes it off, go to the bathroom, come back, put it back on. For years. So there are people like this, that they wear tefillin. I saw when I went to Mattersdorf in Jerusalem one time, I saw tefillat arvit at 10 o'clock at night, with Rav Pinchas Scheinberg, Zatzal, one of the biggest rabbis in the world at that time, with tefillin on his head. It was the chazan, 10 o'clock at night. Doesn't take his tefillin off. All the time, until he goes to sleep. When you go to sleep, you have to take it off. Right? Because you have to get a clean body. Maybe you have gas in the middle of the night. You're not allowed to sleep with tefillin. Can't be distracting your mind from the tefillin. But as long as he's up, even if it becomes dark, he stays with the tefillin on, just like we have tzitzit under the clothes at night. We don't take it off. But there are people like this, that all day were wearing tefillin. Few, maybe hundreds, few, maybe thousands in the world, that's it. The Greeks did not allow. If they catch you with a tefillin, they open up your brain and they drill your brain on a spot. Inside, they stick the knife into the brain. The Gemara said that there was Elisha Baal HaKnafayim, Elisha with the wings. There's an expression. He walked to tefillin, took a life risk. And one of the Greek soldiers saw him, started to run after him. In the meantime, while he was running, he took it off, and he was holding it in his hands, under his dress. The Greek told him, "What do you have in your hand? Show me." He said to him, "I have a bird." Hashem made him a miracle that the tefillin turned into a bird. Elisha Baal HaKnafayim. But nobody else dared to do it. Who would have the guts to walk in the street? We coming to days, even here in America, unfortunately, that we won't be able to walk with a yarmulke here. Just like in some areas in France. Even in Morocco, it's safer than here now. Morocco, an Arab country, it's safer for Jews than here. There's less attacks on Jews in Morocco, hardly ever. It's, the Moroccans are different than the regular Arabs. They always lived in peace with the Jews because the kings of Morocco have a tradition that the Jews is the blessing of the country. Yes, all the king, him, his father, his grandfather. It's very interesting. And they make special pray for the king in a synagogue. They have very good relationship with them. When he landed, I was invited by Rabbi Pinto to go to Morocco. But the date he asked me to come, I already had three plans. So I told him, Bezrat Hashem, later on I'll come. He's now the chief rabbi of Morocco. He moved to Morocco. After what they did to him in Israel, the secular, wicked police and government, he decided he doesn't want to be there anymore. So he moved to Morocco. He had a nice community. People from all over the world come constantly to there. there's something very interesting over there. When you land, as soon as they see you have an Israeli passport, they assign detectives to follow you everywhere you go for protection. Yes. You walk anywhere you walk. You walk a group of Israelis, they go, let's say, on a trip. There's always a car following them. I don't know, always, but that's the rule of the king. Make sure nobody touches them. Because he always, it's enough, out of 1,000 Muslims, you have one murderer, crazy Al-Qaeda one. I'm sure you have in Morocco also crazy people like this. That's all it takes. So they guard them. You know, this wealthy Jew, he told me that he had to go to Morocco for business to meet the king. He told me personally, I met Shabbaton in his house in Riverdale. He told me, do you believe that when I went to Morocco for business to meet the king, they made the entire palace glad kosher for me just for one meal? I told him, you don't need to. We can order kosher food, or I can bring food with me. It's no problem. It comes with the helpers. We can get our own food. No! You are my guest in my house. You will eat in my house. And if you can't eat my food, we will make sure you're going to be able to eat. They brought rabbis. They made everything kosher for him. And he barely ate over there when he came to eat. Respect. Assad. Assad, the king of Syria. You know, he's supposedly a war criminal. He gassed his own people, he killed thousands of people now. They've been fighting there for 6-7 years now. Thousands of people he killed. Assad, the Syrian wealthy Jews from Flatbush, I think 12 of them, took a private jet and flew to Syria about 15 years ago. Something like that, maybe 12 years ago. There's a picture, I saw the picture, they're sitting in his living room. They came to him, as people, Syrian Jews, that their parents lived there, or some of them he may be even born there, I don't know. All the leaders of the community, business people, big business people, went to Syria to discuss with him Israel, United States. Among that, they told him they would like to pay money to renew and reserve the Jewish cemetery in Syria. There's a lot of big rabbis buried there. Rabbi Chaim Vital, the student of the Ari HaKadosh, is buried there. Without him, you would not know one word of Kabbalah in the world today. Everything you know came from him. Ari HaKadosh told him all the Kabbalah and he published it. He's buried in Syria, Rabbi Chaim Vital. And there's many other big Dolim, big Mekubalim. The Syrian Jews were always very religious throughout the generations. You didn't have people with earring and ponytail and tattoo in Syria. You know? Everybody was either very religious or traditionally religious. So what happened is, when they say to Assad, as much as it's gonna cost, we're gonna pay. How much it's gonna cost to fix the cemetery, make a fence, clean it, chop the trees, you know, make a new floor maybe. How much is gonna be? $100,000? Pocket change for them, it's no problem. He said, no, it's an insult for me to make you pay. In my country, it's my obligation to take care of your rabbis. They fixed all the cemetery, and he pays for it. Maybe that's his chud, that they can't get him out of power. Fight him for 6 years like the devil. They can't get rid of him. Hashem send him Putin to be his bodyguard, Putin. Nobody mess with him. Though you're laughing, that could be his chud, just this alone. Hashem says, you stay in power. Same thing happened to Mubarak. Hosni Mubarak, the leader of Egypt, they decided in Egypt to make a highway. And the highway clashing through the Jewish cemetery, and all the big rabbis buried there. If I'm not mistaken, the grandfather of the Baba Sali is also one of them, Rabbi Yaakov Abu Chatzera. He buried in Egypt. So, They said, that's it, we're going to get all the graves out and we make a highway, or we make the highway on the cemetery. We put sand, cover the graves, make a highway. What do I care, Jews buried here? The Goyim over there, the Arabs. It came to the attention of Rav Ovadia Yosef Zatzal. He couldn't believe that that's what they're going to do, make a highway on the Jewish graves. He decided to go to meet Husni Mubarak in a private meeting. He speaks Arabic, so there's no problem. He was born in Iraq, and he was the chief rabbi of Egypt for a few years. So they went there. They went there with the, I think there he went with him and a few others. In a meeting, he said to Mubarak, I'm asking you a favor. If you would move this highway from the Jewish cemetery that doesn't go over the graves of our big rabbis. It's not good for your country, it's not good for the soul, it's gonna... He got him to understand. Husni Mubarak told him, Rabbi, you don't understand how difficult is the request you made. You don't understand. Do you know we're gonna have to redo the whole plan and there's gonna be months to rewrite everything and to plan everything because it's affect the whole thing. I have to move the highway completely. But for your honor, I'm gonna do it. And he did it. And Rav Ovadia gave him a blessing that he should live long life and successful. And they wanted to execute him. There was a trial. They already found him guilty, waiting for execution. Against all odds, by a miracle, all of a sudden they canceled the verdict, released him, and still... what is he, 90? Huh? I don't know. Did he? Did he die? No, I don't know. I never heard he died. Maybe he did. I don't know. But definitely he made it to 90. He lived long life, like the bracha of Rav Ovadia. Let's get a little bit understanding about the Greeks. Who are these Greeks? We are Greeks, Greeks, Greeks. Let's give you some a little bit background. So, the story with the Greeks begin with Aplaton. How do you say it in English? Aplaton. 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 He was the teacher of Aristo. Aristo is a student. He was against idols worshiper. Don't believe in many different gods, don't believe in idols. Also Socrates. Socrates believed in a body and soul, and the soul will remain forever. The soul cannot die, it's a spiritual thing. Who turned the Greeks into infidels? And a nation of heresy. Who was the one responsible for that? Who knows? Aristo. Aristo was the one that was the teacher of Alexander Mokdon. Alexander Mokdon, that was the leader that occupied the whole world and died very young in his 30s, in such short life. Look at the power they had. They didn't have bombs like today, airplane, tanks, atomic bombs. They were fighting with bow and arrow and spears and swords. The Greeks occupy one country after the other. Ask me, how can you occupy the whole world in 10 years, 15 years? Even with guns and bombs and tanks and this, you can't do that. Nobody was able to occupy the whole world. If you try to occupy Iran now, how many years the war gonna be? Could be 50 years war until they surrender. It's very difficult to occupy countries. After they did what they did to one or two or three countries, everybody already know not to mess with them. So when they came, they didn't start a war right away. They sent them a messenger. Would you surrender and pay us taxes? We'll put soldiers over here, governor. We will decide how much you have to give us taxes and we'll let you live free, as you used to before. But you gotta pay us money. How much? 10 million a month. Whatever, depends on how many citizens. Taxes, we collect the taxes. We're in charge of you. Meaning you become our slaves. But we don't wanna destroy you, we don't wanna kill you, we don't wanna put you down. We just want money. And we're going to say the last word about what to do in a country. All countries right away. They wave the white flag. Don't kill us. Here, how much you want? Let's see it. They reached an agreement. That's it. So that's how they went from one country to the other. Everybody was afraid of them. What are we going to do? We don't have the power to fight hundreds of thousands of these Greeks. So quickly, they occupy the whole world. And they arrive later to Israel with the story of Chanukah and the barrel of oil. So Aristo was the teacher of Alexander Mokdon. When he was 30 years old, he finished to occupy the whole world. We know the famous say that he said when he was 30. When he was 30 years old, Alexander Mokdon say, it's a shame there's nothing left to occupy. That's what he said. I'm bored now. What am I going to do now? Who will I kill? Who will I attack? That's it. Everybody is in my pocket. So that's when he was 30 years old. Everywhere he went, the law became Hellenism, the culture of the Greeks, and the gods of the Greeks, and the lifestyle of the Greeks, and the wisdom of the Greeks. Everywhere in the world, this was in the time of the Second Temple in Israel. The first temple was from King Solomon, built 3,000 years ago. It was 410 years and was destroyed. So 2,600 years ago approximately was destroyed. 70 years later was rebuilt, Second Temple, and was standing 420 years. 410, 420. With the 7 years in between, so it's a period of 900 years. So from about 2,900 years ago until 2,000 years ago, you had temples, which was destroyed about 2,000 years ago. So the time of the Second Temple, it's between 2,400 years ago to 2,000 years ago. That's the period that the Greeks were dominant. So what else happened? They actually influenced the Romans also a lot. The Romans that took over after the Greeks started to go down were very influenced by them as well. And later the Romans joined Christianity. You have to understand, JC died about 2,000 years ago. JC never started Christianity. JC had a cult, all kinds of lowlifes and homeless that lived on the street. He gathered them and he became their guru. Then he died. He died as a Jew. But maybe about 300 years after he died, they officially started Christianity. There's different opinions. Some say 7 years after he died. Some say 300 years after he died. Once he died, there was no Christianity. He died as a Jew. Once they decided one day to make him holy, they started with all the fairy tales about him. John, Mark, Matthew, Luke, and the rest of their nonsense. And then they have the additions, which it's called the Acts. Acts 6, Acts 7, the end of the New Testament. What does it mean, John? Yohanan. Yohanan in Hebrew is John. Right? Luke, Lucas. This is the Mark, Matthew, Matthew's Matityahu, Matthew. Okay, that's the names.
Michael.
Huh?
Michael.
Michael is Michael. So, the Christians wanted to form a new religion, but there's nobody interested. Compare this to Judaism. The Romans had no religion. So they came to the Romans and say, you don't have a religion, why don't you join us? We'll all be one nation. The Romans say, no, we don't believe in what you preach. you're doing Brit Milah. First Christian was still keeping Shabbat, still doing Brit Milah. Remember, there's a lot of Jews. So they say, oh, you're cutting parts of the body, you close your businesses in one day a week. It's not for us, we don't believe in it. We believe in walking nonstop, we believe in not touching the body, body has to be complete. So the Christian made a deal with him. Why don't we work out, let's compromise. We will cancel Brit Milah and Shabbat and keep the rest, and you will all join us, millions of Romans. They say yes. And that's when Christianity got a major push. All this time, there's no such thing Christmas or New Year's Eve. It's baloney. JC was now born on December 25th, he didn't die on December 25th, New Year's Eve, it's nothing. For a long, long time, there was no holidays like this in Christianity. Until somebody decided, look, the Jews have so many holidays, we have nothing. Let's do something. Okay, let's make the celebration of JC. So they decided December 25th. All these customs, where they come from. Somebody made it up, and that's it. It's spread all over the world. Tomorrow, half of the world banks are closed. Everywhere you go, Romania, this, Russia, Christmas. It spreads all over the world. Even the Jews have a tree, Chanukah bush. Spoke about it last week. Chanukah bush, shame on them, and their bush. George Bush also has a bush. So what? Whatever. It's such a headache to carry the tree, bring it to your house, put it in your living room, all the dirt. No, fine. So, in the time of the Second Temple, the wisdom of the Greeks was the foundation of all academic studies. Even today, in universities, a lot of the things you learn, it's because of them. A lot of the things you learn, it's because of them. I remember when I was a kid in Israel, shame on them, one of the courses in school was the Greek mythology. That's what they taught us. Rambam, not a word. Gemara, not a word. Mishnah, not a word. Chumash, they teach you Chumash like it's fairy tales. Like Shakespeare, like a novel. Ah, Abraham met Sarah. She was beautiful. He fell in love with her. Like a story, like a play. They call it in Israel, Agadot HaMikra. There is Agadot with A. Like Agadah of Pesach, when you tell a story, and there is Agadot with Aleph. Do you know the difference between Agadah with A and Agadah with Aleph? Agadah with Aleph means fiction. Agadah with A means to tell the story that happened. Look what crooks they are, these Zionist communists. That's how they brainwash all the Israeli kids to become goyim. I myself was their victim, and everybody else. Me, my cousin, my neighbors, the whole school. That's what we learned. Do you know what teacher for Tanakh I had? I'm embarrassed to tell you how she used to come dressed to the class. Total chilonit, koferet, ateistit. Doesn't believe in God bechlal. Teaching us Tanakh. As academic, you have to choose something. When you go to school, to get the credits. That's how they teach it. So, the Greeks, they started to plant their heresy all over the world. Remember, they occupied the whole world. They started to put their studies and philosophy. Many of the things they thought were clever, and not everything stupid, some very smart things. They knew geometry, they knew physics, they knew mathematics. They had philosophy arguments about certain things in life. Among them, they were training the logic. What's logical? That's why they hate the Jews so much. Why they hated the Jews so much? Why they didn't care about other religions in the world? Why they only care to destroy the Jewish religion and to come to destroy the temple? Why? Because the religion of the Jews, 80% of it is against human logic. They couldn't stand it. For instance, they could not stand purity and impurity. But you said, don't touch it, it becomes tameh. They went crazy. What is this nonsense? You're inventing all these things. Don't sit on this chair. Somebody sat there, woman has nida, dead body. Enough with this. They went crazy when he take a baby and cut a piece from his body when he cannot do anything about it. They went crazy when you decide on Shabbat you cannot create fire. It's one thing, you don't want to walk, you want to rest. Okay, that makes sense. But the strange things that you do, you're not allowed to write, you're not allowed this, they went crazy about it. So we drove them crazy because we did things that according to their logic was the total opposite of human logic. They could not understand that there is something called spirituality that is controlling the physics. Today it's a proof today. People get heart attack. How? How they get a heart attack?
Stress.
Stress kill. You can see right away, a person got a bad news, your stocks just crashed. My heart. Falls on the floor and die. Nobody choked him. Nobody clogged his heart. Nobody stuck a knife to his heart. Nobody gave him a poison. Nobody gave him, I don't know, some kind of a drug that kills. Right? Nobody touched him. Understanding in the mind, the spiritual, affected him to die. Or when you worry, you become nervous, you're starting to shake. Your eyes shake, your hands shake, you can eat, you eat too much or you can't eat at all. Everyone reacts differently. So remember I told you 2 weeks ago when we spoke about herpes. Herpes, half of the people in the world has it. I read an article about it, I couldn't believe it. Because it's very easy to get it. It's enough you kiss someone that has it, you get it. It's not, there's two kinds of herpes. One that you need actually intimacy fully. That's the worst kind, all right? But there is one that you get some, all kinds of wounds around the lips. Usually more women gets it. By women it's more common. But when does it come? You can have it for 20 years and you don't know about it. When does it come? Only in a time of stress. When you're nervous about something, you have a big test, or you fail a test, or you're something, a problem with your kid, or in your marriage, it comes out. So you see that the spirituality and the lack of emunah overcome the behaving of the body, very clearly. The Torah said it clearly, and I'm saying you see it in your own eyes, even without reading the Torah. You can see spirituality overcomes everything. Also, the Torah tells us about spirituality, the power of speech. A person say to a woman, "Areat mekudeshetli," and nobody in the world will ever be able to touch her until the day she died, unless he gives her a get. Big deal. Who cares that he say that? And she had to agree. "Areat mekudeshetli," she stands, she receives, she puts her finger, she puts the ring. Nobody can touch her. Someone will be with her, death penalty. For him and her. Big deal, what did I do? I just say a sentence. That's the power of speech. She's forbidden to the whole world. A person has 5,000 sheep, each one worth $300. How much is 5,000 times 300? $1.5 million. $1.5 million worth of sheep. Each one is about $300. 5,000 pieces. He took one sheep. He said, "This sheep is donation to Beit HaMikdash, Hekdesh. It's holy." His wife called him, "Moshe, yes." Without realizing, that sheep got mixed with the 5,000 sheep. And they all look alike, you know. Where is the sheep? Where is the sheep? Where is it? What happened? It's gone. It got mixed. All 5,000 now it's holy. Safek d'orayta lechumra. Can't use it. If it's Hekdesh, you can enjoy from it. It doesn't belong to you. It belongs to Bet HaMikdash. 5,000 sheep you're going to have to give to Bet HaMikdash. Why? They all Safek Kadosh. Can't use it. The power of a word. If a person kept mitzvot 90 years, became Rav Steinemann Zatzal. Tzaddik Yesod Olam, Talmid Chacham, perfect midot. Mezakeh Arabim, whatever you want. Lived in the most simple lifestyle. No materialism, no nothing. Not chumriyut. Mamash Tzaddik Yesod Olam. And then something happened to him when he was 90, this person. And he got angry at Hashem. And he said one sentence from his mouth. Ah, I regret I was religious. Should have not kept all these mitzvot. What did I get? Ma hervachti mize? I wish I can go back and not do it. That's it. 90 years of keeping mitzvot, thousands of hours of Torah, thousands of times he gave tzedakah, thousands of chassadim he did to people, thousands of ba'alei tshuva that became through his teaching and books. Everything he lost in a minute. His file became wiped out. It's called Tohe al Harishonot. You regret that you did mitzvot. Mitcharet al mitzvot, lose it all. Same thing if a person made millions of sins and he regrets them and stop and say, I wish I would not do these sins. That's it. I'm sorry, Hashem, I'm ashamed. Chatati, aviti, pashati. Can erase all of them also with the power of speech. A cow costs $5,000. How many cows we used to sacrifice in the holiday of Sukkot? Which mini atzeret? 70 cows. Only the last one in Shmini Atzeret was for the Jewish people. The other ones are all for the goyim. For each country, a cow. We spent, in today's financial, if a cow costs $5,000, how much is $5,000 times 70? $350,000. Every holiday. For who? For the goyim. That declare that they won't rest until they kill us. We sacrifice for their safety, for their success. That's what the Gemara says. If the goyim would know what they destroyed, they would regret they destroyed Bet HaMikdash. It's against themselves. So today, when we don't have Bet HaMikdash, there is a pasuk, Uneshalma Tarim Sfatenu. $350,000 instead of spending it and doing all the sacrifices, what do you do instead? Speaking. You pay the cows with your lips. Asher yoshev betecha, Hashem sfatai tiftach. That's what it means, neshalma farim sfatenu. Instead of sacrifices, we have prayers. Korban musaf, tfilat musaf. Korban atamit shel shacharit, tfilat shacharit. קורבן של התמיד שבין הארבעים, יאב מנחה. יום כיפור. קורבן of יום כיפור became תפילת יום כיפור, שחרית. Everything, every תפילה, every sacrifice for the public became a prayer. תפילה. That's the power of your lips. Person say a neder and doesn't keep it. His children die. בעוון נדרים מתים בניו של אדם. Person say a neder, doesn't pay it, his wife died. That's if he loves her. She doesn't love her, she lives to 150. He doesn't deserve a prize. He makes a neder and doesn't pay it, and now he's going to get a prize. What is the power of the mouth? You say a neder. This is forbidden to me. This body, you say, you make an eder. You can't touch it. There's a question in halacha that someone said, I swear, I will never look at the face of this guy ever again. He had a friend, he got angry. They got angry. So he swore in a time of, it's actually a neder that he forbid his friend on himself. When you swear, I won't do such and such, that's swearing. When you say this and this is forbidden to me, that's a neder. So he said, the face of this guy, I can never look at him ever again. So the guy died now. And he has a regret now. He wants to go to the funeral. Back in time, they used to leave the body open for the people to come and see. The Christians, I think, they still do it until today.
The Catholic.
Okay, so I know that by Jews they also used to do it, because there's few in the holy books, there's few stories, like the story with the Maharsha. You remember the story with the Maharsha, that one of the yeshiva boys tapped on the big Rasha in the town 450 years ago. They had one Rasha, one wicked Jew that died, and they put him in a synagogue before his funeral to take him. And one of the Bachurei Yeshiva came with his finger and hit him on the nose. If he was covered, he couldn't see his nose. He hit him on his nose, and then that person started to come to him in the dreams, I'm going to kill you, I won't rest until I kill you. Every day he comes to him in a dream, I'll kill you, I'll kill you, I'll kill you, I'll kill you. What did you embarrass me in public? Embarrass me in front of the whole people? He went to the Maharsha, he said, I don't sleep a month already. Can't learn, I can't focus. Every time I sleep, he comes to me. I'm terrified. The Maharsha said, how can it be that someone so wicked have permission to disturb a Bachur Yeshiva? Something doesn't add up here. Something doesn't add up. So, something doesn't add up. So the Maharsha said, let me come sleep by you. When the Bachur woke up, oh my God, he's here again. The Maharsha said to him, come to me, talk to me, spirit of that person. And he said to him, yes, Rabbi. He said, why do you disturb this Bachur Yeshiva? He said, because he embarrassed me in front of all the people in my funeral. So the Rabbi said, you're right, you should have not done it. But I don't understand one thing here. How do they give you permission in Shamayim to disturb a person that learned Torah all day, when everybody here in town already know that you're the worst, wicked person that ever lived in our place? The Maharsha was not politically correct, like some of the leaders today. Told him in his face, you are a Rasha Merusha, why you disturb this Bachur Yeshiva? So he said to the Rabbi, Rabbi, I know you think I'm a Rasha, and I was a Rasha. All the things you say, I really did. But you don't know everything about me. One time I was walking in the street, and I passed by the bridge. As I walked on the bridge, I started to hear someone screaming from the lake. He's drowning. I jumped with my clothes into the lake. I pulled the guy out, and I took him out. And as we both were safe, we started to speak to each other. And I found out that he's a religious boy from yeshiva. And he told me that he's poor and this, and he came here to, you know, like mikveh or to wash his clothes. So I felt bad for him. I started to give him 200 rubles every month. Like this, for a few years I was supporting him and he learned Torah. So when I came up to my trial, they said that I made a lot of sins. I was very big Rasha. But I was a sponsor of Torah. I sponsor a Bachur Yeshiva. That's like an insurance. So they didn't know what to do with me. So they spoke to me and I said, I'm very angry that this boy tapped me on my nose and embarrassed me in front of everyone. I ask permission to take revenge against him. That's what he's worried about. They have to decide if to send him to heaven or hell. And now he's worried about the guy that embarrassed him. By the way, it's not only him. There was a king, Ahav, the husband of Izebel. He was a big Rasha. And he stole the vineyard from a person, his name was what? Navot HaYisraeli. And when he died, then later he killed him, he took his field. And now he went to heaven, and HaKadosh Baruch Hu say, who wants to go and be a trap to this guy Ahav? It's time to take care of him. And he said, I want. And HaKadosh Baruch Hu said to him, Tse, Tse mim chitzati, get out of here, you don't belong here. You are in heaven, and you would like to come back to the world to be a trap, to take revenge against Ahav that took your vineyard and killed you? You don't belong here. You're still thinking about revenge? Tse mim chitzati, took him out of there. Ahav, it's a big question. Idol worshiper, machti arabim, his wife is a murderer, filthy woman, Izevel, kishma keni. Izevel, in Hebrew, you know what it means, Izevel? She's garbage. Mamash interesting. So, two things happened. Ahav, when they went to the war, him and his soldiers, they used to win. David HaMelech not always won. He's tzaddik. His army is tzaddikim, righteous. They sometimes lose. He always win. Why? Because they were all united. All the wicked people united. One other reason, this Ahav was sponsoring Talmidei Yeshiva. Wicked? Yes. Idols? Yes. Mechalel Shabbat? Probably also yes. אבל תלמידי ישיבה, him himself, give them money, learn Torah. That's why it's not so simple to call him Rasha. His Rasha who did a lot of good also at the same time. His wife, Izevel, very, very horrible woman. But she had one mitzvah. When there was a wedding, she used to come, clapping for the bride. Making Sameach Kala. She made the Kalot happy. Later, the prophet told her that the dogs will eat her body, and the dogs ate her, but they didn't touch their hands. Because she was clapping for the Kalot. The dogs ate everything. They left, I think, the legs also, because she was clapping. Everything is measure for measure. The hands that did mitzvah of Sameach Hatan Vekala, the dogs did not touch. Dogs don't have any difference between eating the stomach or the back or the leg or the head, right? It's all the same taste. But they didn't touch the hands. Why? Those are the hands used to clap. So this guy with the Maharsha, he said to the Maharsha, so I sponsored this Bachur Yeshiva for a few years, and now I asked them if I can go and take revenge against this guy who tapped me on my nose. So the Maharsha said, don't be a fool. They are trying to reach a verdict in your trial. Because they couldn't really automatically send you to hell because you sponsor a Bachur Yeshiva, you have a share in all the Torah I learned. So they're trying to prove that you don't really care about the Torah. That's why they allow you to come and bother this guy that learns Torah to show, to make a point in the court of heaven that if this guy sponsored a Bachur Yeshiva, that's not because he was Bachur Yeshiva, just because they were friends, not for the Torah, because if he cares about the Torah, why doesn't he let this Bachur Yeshiva learn? Because of him, he cannot learn a month already. So you see, he doesn't really care about the Torah. So you must let it go, you must forgive him. And now you tell them, I forgive him, he learns Torah, I don't want to do anything to him. That's when they will let you go to a good place. They will save you. Because now you will prove that all the money you gave to the Bachur Yeshiva was really for the learning of Torah. After that conversation, he never showed up again. That's a story that happened with the Maharsha. The Maharsha had very long hair. Very long hair. And a long beard. Why would a rabbi have long hair? Nobody had long hair, ever. You never found rabbis with long hair. That's why you know that all Christians that make paintings of JC, it's all baloney. That statue in Brazil, J.C. have long hair and a goatee. Forget about it. Rabbis didn't look like that 2,000 years ago. Someone who went to yeshiva of Rav Yehoshua ben Farchia doesn't have long hair like a hippie from Woodstock. Who are you? Son of God. Why you have hair like Haman? Even Haman, by the way, Haman had short hair. He was a barber. Haman started as a barber. Then he became the richest guy in the world, Haman. Richer than Chashverosh. Maybe that's why the Bukharian likes to be barber. It's a segula to be a billionaire one day. So nobody had such long hair. So that whole image of JC is baloney. What is this? So it shows you, Rabotai, how terrible it could be. One word the person say, the effect that it has on the world. So let's move on. So the Greeks, they affected Christianity a lot because they affected the Romans who joined Christianity. A lot of the things you see over there came from them. The Midrash in Echa Rabba Bet Yud Gimel, the Midrash say, Im yomar lecha adam, yesh chokhma bagoyim. If someone tells you there is a wisdom among the Gentiles, believe it. They have mathematicians, engineers, big doctors, great chess players, people with photographic memory that remember a lot of things. There's wisdom among the goyim. Statistically, less than the Jews. Jews are the smartest people in the world, and they all admit it. Even in China, you walk with the yarmulke, you're Jewish. That's it. The Jews, they have good reputation when it comes to wisdom. So, it doesn't mean the goyim are not smart. There's goyim that are very smart. So, if someone tells you there's wisdom among the goyim, believe it. If someone say to you there is Torah among the goyim, don't believe it. I want to ask you a question. I think it's a little bit generalizing, no? Well, you don't have goyim that knows Torah? No goy can learn Torah? To learn Torah, it's not like when you learn history, or when you learn politics, or when you learn science. Whatever you learn, you know, that's it, right? To learn Torah, it doesn't matter how much you're gonna learn. In the end, how much you will know and how much you will understand, only Hashem decides. And the way Hashem decides how much you know is not based on how many hours you learn. Is based on how much effort you put. That's when I asked my cousin, my rabbi, many years ago I asked him, how come every question I always ask you, and it's a complicated question, you always know right away by heart the entire thing, the opinions of everybody. Mamash, Rav Eliashiv said this, Rav Ben Zion said this, according to this, you should do this, you should do. How is it like mamash? It's like you're pressing a button and it's in front of you. It's one thing, you learn a lot of things, but to answer instantly without saying, give me an hour, I'll get back to you ever, to know the answers right away, a call clear like this. So he said, what do you think? You think that the knowledge of the Torah is based on how many years you're religious or how many years you learn in yeshiva? No. It's not only how many years you learn. Of course, it's important. If you learn 2 days, you won't know anything. But if you learn 20 years, you can achieve what somebody else achieved in 50 years. 20 and 50, and they know the same. How can it be? You don't have it in college. College, the more you learn, the more you know. The Torah to begin with is above human. It's divine. It's 100% spiritual. It's above the ability of people. That's why it's all a gift from Hashem. That's what happened with the Chazon Ish for 3 days without eating and without sleeping. Was stuck in one line in a Gemara. And keep going and going and going and he can't continue. He keeps getting stuck. Something doesn't add up here. try again, 3 days. Then when he was totally frustrated already, after so many attempts, he hit the floor, the table. It has to go! Chayav lalechet! Chazoni say. I can't get stuck here. That second the answer came to him. Why? From Shamayim. Because he stretched his ability to the max. That's it. He just didn't have any other options. The answer came. It's a whole different movement in learning Torah than anything else you ever learn in your life. That's why when you learn Torah, you have to learn in holiness, in Kedusha and Tahara. Not when you're impure, not without Netilat Yadayim, not when your eyes are contaminated by all kinds of filth in the internet all day. Not when you sit about clowns from the university clown rabbis who destroys the world. They all come from one university and destroy the whole world. Everywhere they go to become rabbis, immediately become conservative and reform. They still call themselves modern Orthodox because they are liars, but they're 100% reform. You have to see their bloriot, you have to see how they talk. Even when they speak Divrei Torah, you feel like you hear a Christian speaker in university. Even the way they present the Torah, it's like a class in college. You see the tum'ah from every word that comes out of their mouth. That's not Torah of yeshivot. Sfaradi, Ashkenazi, Hasidi, doesn't matter. You know when you come to yeshiva, if yesh sham kedusha or not. By them there's no kedusha, it's only university field. There are Greeks who knew Torah just like they know. Same thing. They knew Torah, what do you think? You know, in Israel you have professors for Talmud. If you don't know anything from your life and they're going to give you a nice speech about the Talmud, yeah, you'll be so impressed. You come to him, hey, Kvod Arav, where is your kippah? Kvod Arav, where is your kippah? What kippah? You just gave a beautiful speech about the Talmud for 2 hours. Efo hakippah shelcha? I'm not religious. Well, you just gave a beautiful speech, Gemara, Bet Shammai, Bet Hillel, the history of the Talmud, Rav Ashi, Ravina, this, that. What's going on here? Well, yeah, I'm an atheist. That's my job, I teach Talmud. There are women like this, Professor Le Talmud. He learns Gemara with cigarettes on Shabbat, preparing the class for the university in Israel for Sunday. Like this, no jokes. Reality! Him and his boyfriend. Professor for Talmud. That's what the university does to people. Not always. There's some righteous people that stayed righteous in university. There's always an exception to the rule. But in general, the general rule. I say to one rabbi, yesterday, good one, here in New York, I spoke to him on the phone, I said, I cannot believe what's happening here. Every place I travel to, I meet the same perot be'ushim of that university that destroy every place they go with their rotten ideology. We heard some of their speeches about homosexuality and feminism and inviting Christian and inviting a Muslim imam and inviting Dr. Root, the expert for the field, the Machtiyat Arabim, the biggest in the Jewish history maybe, and how they kiss up to her in the inside the shul, and they call it Orthodox shul. Those are the product of that university. Can't believe I once spoke there. I have to do 500 years tshuva for stepping there. Back then I didn't know. But anyway, I told him, so he asked me, I'm surprised that you're so shocked. Why didn't you know? That's what it's from today. Big rabbis 20 years ago already won from it. Big, serious Ashkenazi rabbis. Spoke very strongly against that places. That the Torah become an academic scholarship. That's okay, you become a scholar academically. Torah, it's not academic. Torah, it's not university. Torah, it's not public high school. You don't learn it in the internet, and you don't learn it that the way some people do today. Torah, you must learn with Kedusha and Tahara, with devotion, 100% seriousness. It's important how you dress when you learn. It's important how much you sweat when you learn. Lefum tzara agra. The more you put suffering into that, the more Hashem will give you gifts. He will only give you gifts if you deserve of it. If you're secular, if you're a faker, if you have rotten ideology, if you go to the gay parade and take picture with the gays and put it on your Facebook page, you will never know the real truth of the Torah. Because you yourself are the filth, just like those abomination people. You're not different, even though you call yourself a rabbi, but you know, someone who knows exactly who you are. The same clown from Englewood just published another book now. You have to see the name of the book. If you ask the worst Rasha in Sodom to call his book 3,400 years ago by the name he called his book, he would not agree from the embarrassment. Can't even say it in front of a camera. You cannot believe the name. In pornographic films, you don't have names like this. That's not the first time. It's already the second field he published, this clown. And you know, there are religious newspapers who ask them to write articles. They publish their articles. They're destroying those religious, innocent people who don't know anything from their life. That's the danger, Rabotai. The danger is not just the Greeks. We have Greeks among us. Some of them have beautiful beards even. Yes. I want to finish just this because I'm stuck here in the middle. The Greek believed in one major belief. What is it? The main thing in life is physical pleasure. That's the purpose of life, to enjoy the world. Enjoy steaks, enjoy red wine, enjoy beer, enjoy sushi, enjoy pizza, enjoy soccer game, enjoy basketball game, enjoy sheshbesh, enjoy cards, enjoy tennis, enjoy swimming, enjoy jet ski, enjoy vacation, enjoy nice clothes, enjoy cosmetic treatment, enjoy that, enjoy... 90% of us are 100% Greeks. Who are we fooling? That's also the main thing in our life. If a religious family spends $100,000 to go to Passover to Mexico and sit by the beach over there, then we are 100% Greeks. If you ask Rav Avigdor Miller to go on vacation to Cancun for Pesach and we'll give him $1 million to be there, would he agree? Huh? What do you say? You ask Rav Ben Zion Abba Shaul to go to a vacation, would he agree? You tell Chacham Ovadia, Rabbi, we want you to sit in Cancun on Pesach. Eat matzot made in Mexico. I would think you totally lost your mind. Well, you know who you're talking to? Are you serious? You want to send me to those places for the holiest holiday, sitting over there? So, the Tfisa Yevanit, the Greek ideology that the main thing in life is physical pleasure. And that's obviously the total contradiction of Judaism. Judaism, every step you make, every breath you breathe, every move you make, you will be judged on it. Greeks, achol v'shato ki machar namut. Eat and drink, stuff yourself with pleasure, because anyway we're going to be dead soon. Grab as much as you can. Two different worlds. They also had Greek beards. There was no Gillette yet. Yeah, Herzl also had beard. You saw the beard of Herzl? Wow. Herzl. So, the Jews say there is one God and two worlds. The Greeks had one world and many gods. The Greeks, everything that is pretty is holy. They sanctify it. By the Jews, everything that is holy, it's pretty. The exact opposite. The culture of the Greeks has no foundation. They worship external beauty and pleasure. Theaters, stadium, sport, dancing, going out, things like that. Everyone in Athens had slaves. That's a part of pleasure. I'm going to wash dishes. I'm going to bring water from the well. They owned slaves. Why? The slaves will do everything. Athens was full of slaves. 70% of Athens people were slaves. 30% masters, 70% slaves. But not slaves like today that get paid. Slaves that get kicked in the head if they late 1 minute making you coffee. These kind of slaves. A person was allowed by the law of Greece to torture the slave, to kill him, and there's no judgment for that. Nobody is looking for any justice. You own him, you can do whatever you want to him. You can hang him. You don't like his face anymore, hang him. Nobody touch anything. We are the masters and they are the slaves. That's where the laws of the Greek Empire in Greece. Someone that were not Greek had a name. What was his name? Barbar. That's where the word barbari came from. It's a Greek word. Barbar, just like Hitler had Aryans. And everyone that is not Aryan doesn't deserve to live. Jews, blacks, all the other people. Aryan. The interesting part is that the Nazis made a brochure how a perfect Aryan has to look. They took a blonde, beautiful boy. They took a picture of his front, of his side. Later on, after the war, someone found out that this kid was a Jew. That was for the Nazis a perfect Aryan. It was a Jew. Mamash, I'm almost done. Almost finished. You will have a month break from me, don't worry. Soon. Yeah. So when a person is not Greek, he's called barbar. And has no rights whatsoever. Not even one right. Nothing. They can do whatever they want to you. You have no say. You can't go to court. You can't file the complaint. Look at the life the people had. 70% of Athens. Even the right to live he doesn't have. We will decide if you live or die. Nobody cares. The Greeks create themselves a religion, man-made religion, that's full of idols, like man-made gods. They put them in the Olympus mountain, all kinds of statues. There was the house of the gods. Olympus, today they have a basketball team called Olympiacos. Very big team in Europe. Where does it come? From this Olympus. What's the word Olympus? It's come from Hebrew. Elim, El. Elim in Greeks. They're full of desires. All they drink, intimacy with everyone, like worse than Sodom and Gomorrah. All day, they're mamash invested in their life full times pleasure. Now, not to waste a minute. Baths, all kinds of creams, oils, gym, shaving the hair, putting oil in the hair, all kinds of horrible pornographic lifestyle. Art. That's it. They actually put that poison in the world that we all suffer from, even as Jews, unfortunately. Mitolelim kol chayim. They are full of revenge, full of pride. Jealousy over there was crazy. Like competition, material competition, who has more? They made their constitution that a person is allowed to do every abomination he wishes to. There's no shame. Whatever you want. The more you are corrupted, the more you are like the gods on the Olympus. It was an honor for them to be corrupted. It's unbelievable. similar to Sodom and Gomorrah. And that's the exact opposite of the Torah. That's why they hated us so much. We disturbed their belief and will. That a person, that Hashem created the human being in his spiritual image, and a person must do everything he can to look like his God. They couldn't stand that Jewish belief. Ma'u rachum afata chanun, ma'u kadosh afata kadosh. He's merciful, you must be merciful. He's holy, you must be holy. When the Greeks arrived to Israel, they started to force their culture and ideology and mythology everywhere. They built stadium in Jerusalem, as it's written in the book of the Chashmonaim. They made competition. They made shows. Slowly, slowly, they attracted all the Jews, were all religious, into their places. Concerts, competition, men against the bear, someone against the lion, two slaves, who's gonna die? A lot of entertainment, sport. Why you call sport sport? It came from Sparta. They created a lot of action. Boxing, wrestling, throwing a metal ball, throwing a spear. They invented a lot of sport. Everything you see on the Olympiada today come from Olympus, from them, everything. Today we have more modern sport like basketball, football, all these things. But the foundation of everything came from them. A lot of ignorant Jews started to follow them. They called mityavnim, people that became Greeks. People that wanted to be free. Wow, they released us from the yeshiva. They released us from the rabbis. Wow, it's so great. We're so happy that the Greeks came to Israel. The Greeks taught philosophy, but they took God out of the equation. Jewish philosophy, you cannot make one step and one sentence without connecting it to Hashem. Without Hashem, there's no philosophy. They created philosophy, keeping Hashem out of the picture, just like the universities today. They gave a person legitimacy to create his own gods and to worship whoever he wants and to follow his desires. The Greek philosophy never claimed there's no creator to the world. They are not that stupid. We have a lot of our people from our nation, they said the world was made from a random explosion. The Greeks were not that stupid. You cannot say that this battle was made by itself. Definitely you can say the world was made by itself. They are not stupid people when it comes to logic. So they all say there is a creator to the world. Why? You have a creation, you have a creator. What's the question? They knew that. But they say that the creator is so great and so big, it's impossible that he will stay in touch with his lousy world. Such a low world. So the creator made the world and left us here. That's why there's no ethics. That's why there's no Musar, morality. He left gods here to run the show, the wind, the rain, the health, the money, the god of the ocean. They made a lot of theories. And that's why they ordered the Israelis to write on the horn of their ox, not that there is no God. En lanu chelek be'elokei Israel. They never said, right, there's no God. Like today, say you're an atheist. You want to be among us? You must say you're an atheist. If you say you believe in God, we don't want you here. You're primitive. That's today. The Greeks didn't say, don't say, the Greeks didn't tell you, say there's no God. They knew there's a God that made the world. They just say, right, that you have nothing to do with him. Enough dreaming that you have connection to that God. That's what it is. The Greeks, refuse to accept the term miracle. There's nature, there's laws of nature that God made, and that's it. There's no such thing miracle. There's no such thing going above the laws of nature and changing it for some individual, like Avraham Avinu, all the stories of the Torah, they never accepted it. After the destruction of the first temple, a big philosopher came from Greece to Israel. He passed by the destruction of the first temple on the Temple Mount, and he saw Jeremiah the prophet is crying on the floor, killing himself from crying. He was wondering. He asked Yirmiyahu two questions. Are you a big scholar among the Jews? Why are you crying for pieces of wood and pieces of rocks that are broken? Meaning you should know better than that, if you're smart, no? And if it was destroyed already, how is it going to help you to cry over it? Move on to the future. What are you stuck in the past? The Greek philosopher was saying to Yirmiyahu. Yirmiyahu was how many years ago? 2,500 years ago, approximately. That's right after the destruction of the first temple. Yirmiyahu told him, you probably have some philosophy doubts that you still don't know the answer to. So now it's your chance to ask me every doubt you ever had, and I will answer you all of them. And he started to ask him a lot of hard questions about life, about the world. Yirmiyahu immediately answered him all his questions one by one. The prophet of Hashem. The philosopher was shocked. He asked him, where did you get such knowledge and wisdom? Yirmiyahu told him, all my wisdom came from these rocks and from these pieces on the floor that I'm crying for. And for your second question, that a smart scholar should not cry about the past, I cannot answer you, because you won't be able to understand that anyway. You understand? In a time of Elisha the prophet with Eliyahu HaNavi, there was a famous philosopher in Greece, his name was Homerus. The Greeks had a lot of wisdom say, lots of expressions. Where did they get them from? They have books full of words of wisdom. Where did it come from? It was all stolen from King Solomon's library. After the destruction of the second temple, it's written, Vaydaber shloshet alafim mashal, vayishiro chamisha va'elef. It's in a book of Kings A, chapter 5, verse 12. It's written that the nations came to hear the wisdom of King Solomon from all over the world. And they heard his wisdom. And all this wisdom of King Solomon were all written in books. And when the temple was destroyed, they all came and grabbed it. And the wisdom of the Jews and King Solomon went and started to spray. And many of that the Greeks got. When Alexander Mokdon occupied Jerusalem, Aristo got his hands on the treasure of many of King Solomon's books. Everything good he found them that he liked, he put his name on it and added some of his nonsense to it and heresy and canceled the supervision of Hashem and took it out of the books. To cover that he did not get it from the Jews, because everyone knows Greeks don't talk about God's supervision. So he modified it. The wisdom of Aristo and his style, he was the head of the philosophers. He was famous all over the world. He knew biology, zoology, the horoscope, astronomy, the movement of the stars, math. It wasn't just an ordinary person. Even the Rambam speaks about him. He also knew a lot about God. But when you have philosophy that is detached from Hashem, obviously you reach the wrong conclusion. So, in metaphysics, meaning the investigating of the purpose of the world and the behaving of the world, from the beginning until our days, the philosophers have no rest. They keep assuming and build all kinds of systems based on assumption in every generation. Aristo's opinion was that a person and the good, The person is activated, his thought in a positive way. He is a person that is happy. If he uses his brain correctly, he reaches happiness. Happiness for him is life with peace and perfect achievement. That's a person that is a great philosopher, according to Aristo, is someone that reached the maximum level of his thinking. That's what it is. Aristo made some critical mistakes in it. The Ramban writes, those who follow the Greek Aristo, that denied everything that cannot be proven by the five senses. So if you see it, if you feel it, if you touch it, it exists. Many of us speak like that today, a lot of secular Jews. He is the one who started to say it. And Ramban speaks about his mistakes. All his svarot, all his assumptions, turned most of them to be nonsense. Aristo thought that the first creator of the world created everything and is above everything and is not interfering with anything in the world after he made the rules and left the world alone. The Torah say you cannot make one step without Hashem. Can't move your hand, everything is supervised, even a leaf that falls from the tree is 100% from Hashem, supervision, judgment, everything is recorded, everything is judged, everything is a consequence of something else that people chose to do. Complete opposite philosophy. And the only existence of the world is only because HaKadosh Baruch Hu decided that the world will go another hour, and another hour, and another hour, and another minute. Without that, the world will never, ever survive. So we finished here. This was just finally, we went deep to know where it started. The Greeks and the Jews. And why we bother them so much? A lot of the things I just mentioned to you still remain in power today. The only difference is that you don't need the Greeks, you don't need Aristo. You have it in Israel, in a Supreme Court. You have it in Israeli Knesset. You have it in every Israeli university. The Israelis and the American Jews, unfortunately, chose to become the new Greeks. And then they have the guts to light Chanukah menorah and sing Ma'oz Tzur Yeshuati Lechana El Shabeach. After they fight Hashem in every step of their life. Hanerot halalu anachnu madlikim al hanisim ve'al haniflaot, and they deny miracles. But they sing about the miracles because they don't even listen to what they sing. If one secular atheist that light Chanukah candle would listen to what he reads, he will never do it ever again. He will feel a great contradiction. I declare that everything I just read is not true. So why am I reading it? Do you understand? But nobody think. Nobody used their heads. Millions of people. Now, they're almost everyone in Israel light menorah. That's mitzvah with luck. The secular Jews are crazy about Chanukah. Chanukah parties, donuts, this. Technically, this should be a mourning day for them. 8 days of mourning. Why? Chanukah is that the Haredim, the ultra-fanatic Orthodox that did not bow down to the Greeks, did not compromise, did not go to the stupid university and learn their nonsense and became looking like them and went to their stadiums and changed their names to their names and married their women. Those that did not do it survived and defeated them. So why are we celebrating? We are like the Greeks. We marry goyim, we eat their food, we call their children with their names, we go to their stadiums, we believe in their beliefs. We are one, not 99%, 100% Greeks. As a matter of fact, worse than them. Because some things that the Greeks say, for instance, the Greeks say there is a God, he made the world. Many secular people even that deny. So who's worse? But we still have the guts to celebrate Chanukah. This is the words of Chazal, Rabotai. Alma de Shikra. The world of lie. Everything in this world is a lie. Some, it's 100% lies. Some, 90%. Some, 50%. Some, 10% lie. Lies in everywhere, even in the yeshivot, you have lies. Two people fight with a Gemara just for the ego, not for the truth. They don't really care if Rashi writes or Tosfot. They care if my Svara will win or your win. That's also a lie. That's not supposed to be in yeshiva. When they throw kids in yeshiva for something minor that they did and they let him fall off the derech and become a drug addict, that's not a part of yeshiva. Yeshiva is a hospital for the soul. In a hospital for the soul, you don't take a patient that it's a little bit troublemaker, meaning his body gives us some extra hard time, and you throw his bed to the street to die, just because it's too much to take care of him. Hospital must take care of all patients. Yeshiva should have take care of all children. Thousands of children were thrown to the street. They became totally secular, anti-religion, and the biggest enemies of religion today. They are the ones who make websites against the Torah. They are the ones who show all kinds of things that looks funny a little bit and strange, because if you don't understand what the Gemara meant, it looks strange, and they take advantage on their knowledge in Gemara, and they bring thousands of souls to the garbage, to Gehenom. And who's gonna pay for that? Those people who threw them from the yeshiva to the street, just because they didn't want their annoying behaving. You're too annoying. You're too charismatic. You're a leader. One person, I asked him, why did you throw this kid out? He has filter internet. Doesn't have access to internet. He never spoke to girls. He dressed black and white. He comes on time. He learns. He davens. So I use few words that are not appropriate. Everybody else of his friends in the class are speaking like that. Why you throw him and you don't throw the others? Either he closed the yeshiva and throw everyone out. You can't throw one and leave all the other one in. Guess what the answer was? He is a leader. The other one are followers. So we cut the fish from the head. The snake, sorry. Cut the snake from the head. That's a word of a mechanech b'Israel. If the kids sell drugs to kids, of course you have to take him out. Before everybody else will be dead. If he teach them kfira, if he show them dirty movies, there are certain times you cannot keep a kid in yeshiva with all the pain. Because if he's going to stay, everybody else will be like him. But I tell you from experience that I've seen hundreds of times over the years that they threw kids from the yeshivot for nothing. For nothing. For saying, what the heck, they threw a kid, today's a heroin addict. I follow that family. For saying, what the heck, not hell, what the heck. They warn him and he said it again. They warn him, he said it again, three times. For the ego. That he doesn't respect them, they threw him out. And he was a very good student. Everything, Gemara, Rashi. So he had a few bad words that he said. You take a 13 years old kid, why don't you take him into the room, put your hand around his shoulder, son, we are religious people, we have to work on your language. You know? Buy him maybe a pizza, maybe take him to the pizza, give him a can of Coke, something. Once or twice, he'll be embarrassed to speak bad. You resolve the problem in 1 hour. It's much easier. I'm the boss. Yalla, throw him out. When someone came to Rav Ben Zion Abba Shaul Zatzal in Porat Yosef, one of the rabbis, Rabbi, I cannot teach here when this kid is in this yeshiva. You must throw him out. Igiu maim ad nafesh. It's killing me. The melamed say. Rav Ben Zion Abba Shaul say, okay. He took his pen out and a piece of paper and he wrote, I, Rabbi such and such from Porat Yosef, take upon myself full responsibility for what's going to happen to the soul of this kid named such and such. From today's date, such and such date, from the minute we throw him out of the yeshiva to the street, I'm responsible for all the Shabbatot he's not going to keep, for all the treif he's going to eat, for all the things he will steal, for the Goya that he will get married to, from all the horrible things that he's going to do against Hashem and the Torah, I take fully responsibility for that, and that's why he's out of the door, out of the yeshiva. sign here, please, and he's out of the door. But he couldn't sign, this hypocrite. Whoever he was, I don't even know. The story, it's in the book, but they don't say obviously who did it. He didn't sign, because all of a sudden it hit him. I'm going to have to pay for it one day. But they don't think. Today they don't think. They think they're going to get away with that. Because somebody's a little bit annoying. Kids, 14, 15, kids. How much brain kids have? It takes time until they grow up. Especially in today's generation. Today, the level of the world is not what it used to be 30 years ago. There's no question about it. When we were kids, and when I see kids today, secular kids, nothing to compare. Same thing, you can compare Israeli soldiers today, secular one, than when the time where we were in the army. People had a lot of knowledge and independence and wisdom and many different things. People used to read books, there was no internet, the brain was functioning. We were all wicked because we never grew up religious. But at least there was some values. Today, you look at the kids today, you cannot believe it's possible. They are the chiefs of the army, Rabotai. They will occupy the court, the Supreme Court, the lawyers' offices. They will be the doctors. They will be the pilots in El Al. Give it another 10, 20 years, the world will come to an end. Because you're not going to have enough people to occupy all these sensitive jobs. Who's going to be in 200 nuclear bombs? Who? People that smoke grass every day? Almost every Israeli smoke grass from morning to night nonstop. He's going to have to be in charge of 200 atomic bombs that can destroy the world? Imagine what would happen when they smoke one cigarette more. What can happen to the world? That's what's going to happen. They already caught a lot of pilots coming to the flight drunk. Not in Israel, Baruch Hashem. Not yet. But in other countries. They got on a flight drunk. He doesn't know how to turn the is about to crash 500 people. They arrested one pilot 6 months ago. Here, in American Airlines. They took him out of the flight with handcuffs. The, I don't know, FBI, the whatever their name is. TSA, whatever. He was about to crash 500 people. What do you think would happen? We'll bang into one wall or car, who knows what? This is what's happening, Rabotai. The secular people of 30, 40 years ago, none of them almost were divorced. Today, almost everyone is divorced. Nobody was a drug addict 30 years ago. One out of a million. Today, almost everybody. Check what's going on in the world. How long the world would continue to go lower and lower? That's the bottom. They can't go lower than that. That's why we need Mashiach now more than ever before. I said, if Hashem won't bring it now, who is he going to bring it for? For who? For 500 people? For 5,000 people? For how many people the Mashiach would come in the end? How many people have real emunah, real devotion, real knowledge in Torah, real Shabbos, Yirat Shamayim, no Lashon Hara, no horrible, terrible abomination crimes? How many? Things I discover every day, I can't believe it. Imagine if people tell me, and I hear these things from their mouth, imagine how much they hide. That's what they tell me. You know, the embarrassment. Imagine how much worse it is when husbands and wives talk about the problems. They hold back. They're embarrassed. After all, what are you going to say to the rabbi? From what I hear already, I faint. Remember, Rabotai, Chanukah, it's not donuts and it's not candles. This is just a symbol. Chanukah is to become fully devoted, religious, 100%. Shomer kala kevachamura, the Torah is my life. The Torah is the primary things in my life. Everything else is optional, secondary. Torah is everything. Every time my job will collide with Torah, the Torah will win and I'll quit the job, even if I lose money. When it comes to choose a soulmate, the Torah will be my guideline. When it comes to choose where to put my children to learn, the Torah is my guideline. When I need to buy a computer, I do it by the Torah. When I need to buy a phone, I do it by the Torah. When I need to buy a car, I follow the Torah. I won't drive a Ferrari and not a Bentley, even if I have $1 billion. Why? The Torah says, stay humble. Don't be a show-off. You're not a peacock. Peacock, he opened his feathers, he wants to show off. Torah gives the answer to everything. If you are in a Torah, you're never going to become like what we see in front of eyes. That's what Chanukah is about. That's why we need an annual reminder. We forget the main thing about Chanukah. People forget it. They're not even thinking what Chanukah is about. Chanukah means we say to Hashem, you see, the whole world is against you, but we will never leave you. If it costs us, if we get killed, just like the Maccabees. Not the Maccabees that play in Tel Aviv. It's all American black people. They have nothing to do with Judaism. Good professional player that comes to play. What are they? They're not Jews. The Maccabees became black goyim from America. What's their connection to Judaism? None. The Maccabees of the Torah, Maccabee means, and we finish, Mi kamocha ba'elim Hashem. Who is like you among these fake gods, Hashem? No one is like you. You're the one and the only one and the one before the heaven and after there will not be another like the Pasuk said. Thank you very much. Happy Chanukah. Next Tuesday, the last lecture, and plus after that there will be another event. Please take flyers here. Thank you.